Meditations on Savitri. All forms are tokens of some veiled idea, whose covert purpose lurks from mind's pursuit, yet is a womb of sovereign consequence. There every thought and feeling is an act, and every act a symbol and a sign, and every symbol hides a living power. Sri Aurobindo. Savitri, a legend and a symbol. Savitri is an experiment in mystic poetry, spiritual poetry cast into a symbolic figure. The whole of Savitri is, according to the title of the poem, a legend that is a symbol, and this opening canto, it may be said, a key beginning and announcement. The physical night and physical dawn are, as the title of the canto clearly suggests, a symbol, although what may be called a real symbol of an inner reality. And the main purpose is to describe by suggestion the thing symbolized. Then from a timeless plane that watches time, a spirit gazed out upon destiny. In its endless moment saw the ages pass, all still was in a silence of the gods. The prophet moment covered limitless space. Over wide earth brooded the infinite bliss. Savitri, this prophetic vision of the world's history, including the announcement of the earth's future. Who can ever dare to paint it in pictures? Yet the mother and Huta have tried it this way. We simply meditate together on the lines chosen, and when the image becomes clear, I describe it with the help of a few strokes. Then Huta goes to her studio and brushes the painting. It is in a meditative mood that these meditations must be looked at to find the feeling they contain behind their appearance. The mother. Descend, O happiness, with thy moon-gold feet. Enrich earth's floors upon whose sleep we lie. It was the hour before the gods awake. Across the path of the divine event, the huge foreboding mind of night, alone in her unlit temple of eternity, lay stretched immobile upon silence marge. Almost one felt opaque, impenetrable, in the somber symbol of her eyeless muse, the abysm of the unbodied infinite, a fathomless zero occupied the world. A mute, featureless semblance of the unknown, repeating forever the unconscious act, prolonging forever the unseen will, cradled the cosmic drowse of ignorant force, whose moved creative slumber kindles the suns and carries our lives in its somnambulist whirl, athwart the vain enormous trance of space, its formless stupor without mind or life, a shadow spinning through a soulless void, thrown back once more into unthinking dreams. Earth wheeled, abandoned in the hollow gulfs, forgetful of her spirit and her faith. Then something in the inscrutable darkness stirred, a nameless movement, an unthought idea, insistent, dissatisfied, without name, something that wished but knew not how to be, teased the inconscient to wake ignorance. An unshaped consciousness desired light, and a blank prescience yearned towards distant change, as if a childlike finger laid on a cheek, reminded of endless need in things, the heedless mother of the universe, an infant longing, clutched the somber vast. Arrived from the other side of boundlessness, an eye of deity pierced through the dumb deeps, a scout in the reconnaissance from the sun. It seemed amid a heavy cosmic rest, the torpor of a sick and weary world, to seek for a spirit soul and desolate, too fallen to recollect forgotten bliss. All can be done if the God touch is there. A hope stole in that hardly dared to be amid the night's forlorn indifference, as if solicited in an alien world with timid and hazardous instinctive grace. Orphaned and driven out to seek a home, an errant marvel with no place to live, into a far-off nook of heaven there came, a slow, miraculous gesture's dim appeal, a wandering hand of pale enchanted light that glowed along a fading moment's brink. Fixed with gold panel, an opalescent hinge, a gate of dreams ajar on mystery's verge, one loosened corner, windowing hidden things, forced the world's blind immensity to sight. The darkness failed and slipped like a falling cloak from the reclining body of a god. A glamour from the unreached transcendences, iridescent with the glory of the unseen, a message from the unknown immortal light, a blaze upon creation's quivering edge, dawn built her aura of magnificent hues and buried its seed of grandeur in the hours. On life's thin border, a while the vision stood and bent over Earth's pondering forehead curve. Once more, a tread perturbed the vacant vast infinity's center, a face of rapturous calm parted the eternal lids that open heaven. A form from far beatitude seen to near, ambassadress twixt eternity and change, the omniscient goddess leaned across the breadth that wrapped the fated journeyings of the stars and saw the spaces ready for her feet. Earth felt the imperishable's passage close. The waking ear of nature heard her steps, and wideness turned to her its limitless eye, and scattered on sealed depths her luminous smile, kindled to fire the silence of the world. All grew a consecration and a rite. Air was a vibrant link between earth and heaven, the wide winged hymn of a great priestly wind arose and failed upon the altar hills. Thy boughs prayed in a revealing sky. Here, where our half-lit ignorance skirts the gulfs on the dumb bosom of the ambiguous earth, here where one knows not even the step in front, and truth has a throne on the shadowy back of doubt, on this anguished and precarious field of toil, outspread beneath some large, indifferent gaze, impartial witness to our joy and veil, our prostrate soil bore the awakening ray. A sacred yearning lingered in its trace, the worship of a presence and a power, too perfect to be held by death-bound hearts, the prescience of a marvelous birth to come. The excess of beauty natural to God-kind could not uphold its claim on time-born eyes, too mystic real for space tenancy. Her body of glory was expunged from heaven. The rarity and wonder lived no more. There was the common light of earthly day. A franchise from the respite of fatigue, once more the rumor of the speed of life pursued the cycles of our blinded quest. All sprang to their unvarying daily acts. The thousand peoples of the soil and tree obeyed the unforeseeing instant's urge, and leader here with his uncertain mind, alone who stares at the future's covered face, man lifted up the burden of his fate. And Savitri, too, awoke among these tribes that hastened to join the brilliant summoner's chant, and, lured by the beauty of the apparent ways, acclaimed their portion of ephemeral joy, akin to the eternity whence she came. No part she took in this small happiness, a mighty stranger in the human field. The embodied guest within made no response. the call that wakes the leap of human mind, its checkered, eager motion of pursuit, its fluttering-hued illusion of desire, visited her heart like a sweet alien note. Time's message of brief light was not for her. In her there was the anguish of the gods, imprisoned in our trenchant human mold, the deathless conquered by the death of things. A vaster nature's joy had once been hers, but long could keep not its gold heavenly hue, or stand upon this brittle earthly base, a narrow movement on time's deep abysm, life's fragile littleness denied the power, the proud and conscious whiteness and the bliss she had brought with her into human form, the calm delight that weds one soul to all, the key to the flaming doors of ecstasy. Earth's grain that needs the sap of pleasure and tears rejected the undying rapture's boon offered to the daughter of infinity, her passion flower of love and doom she gave. Inflicting on the heights the abysms of law, it sullies with its mire heaven's messengers. Its thorns of fallen nature are the defense it turns against the Savior hands of grace. It meets the sons of God with death and pain. Too unlike the world, she came to help and save. Her greatness weighed upon its ignorant breast, and from its deep chasm welled a dire return, a portion of its sorrow, struggle, fall. To live with grief, to confront death on her road, the mortal's lot became the immortal's share. Thus trapped in the gin of earthly destinies, awaiting her ordeal's hour abode, outcast from her inborn felicity, accepting life's obscure terrestrial role, hiding herself even from those she loved, the Godhead greater by a human faith. Even in this moment of her soul's despair, in its grim rendezvous with death and fear, no cry broke from her lips, no call for aid. She told the secret of her woe to none. Calm was her face, and courage kept her mute against the evil at life's afflicted roots, her own calamity, its private sign, her pain she made a mystic, poignant sword. At the summons of her body's voiceless call, her strong, far-winging spirit traveled back, back to the yoke of ignorance and faith, back to the labor and stress of mortal days, lighting a pathway through strange symbol dreams, across the ebbing of the seas of sleep, Her house of nature felt an unseen sway, illumined swiftly were life's darkened rooms, and memory's casements opened on the hour, and the tired feet of thought approached her doors. All came back to her, earth and love and doom. Immobile in herself, she gathered force. This was the day when Satyavan must die. End of Canto I, Book I. Beginning of Book I, Canto II. An absolute supernatural darkness falls on man sometimes when he draws near to God. An hour comes when fail all nature's needs, forced out from the protecting ignorance and flung back on his naked primal need. He at length must cast from him his surface soul and be the ungarbed entity within. That hour had fallen now on Savitri. Around her were the austere sky-pointing hills and the green, murmurous, broad, deep spotted woods muttered incessantly their muffled spell, a dense, magnificent colored, self-wrapped life, draped in the leaves' vivid emerald monotone and set with checkered sunbeams and blithe flowers, immured her destiny's secluded scene. There had she grown to the stature of her spirit, the genius of titanic silences, steeping her soul in its wide loneliness, had shown to her herself's bare reality, and mated her with her environment. Its solitude greatened her human hour, with a background of the eternal and unique. A force of spare direct necessity reduced the heavy framework of man's days and his overburdening mass of outward needs to a first thin strip of simple animal wants, and the mighty whiteness of the primitive earth, and the brooding multitude of patient trees, and the musing sapphire leisure of the sky, and the solemn wake of the slowly passing months had left in her deep room for thought and God. There was her drama's radiant prologue lived. Here, with the suddenness divine advents have, repeating the marvel of the first descent, changing to rapture the dull earthly round, love came to her, hiding the shadow, death. Well might he find in her his perfect shrine, since first the earth being's heavenward growth began, through all the long ordeal of the race, never a rarer creature bore his shaft, that burning test of the Godhead in our parts, a lightning from the heights on our abyss. All in her pointed to a nobler kind. Near to earth's wideness, intimate with heaven, exalted and swift, her young, large-visioned spirit, voyaging through worlds of splendor and of calm, overflew the ways of thought to unborn things. Ardent was her self-poised, unstumbling will, her mind a sea of white sincerity, passionate in flow, had not one turbid wave. As in a mystic and dynamic dance, a priestess of immaculate ecstasies, inspired and ruled from truth's revealing vault, moves in some prophet cavern of the gods, a heart of silence in the hands of joy, inhabited with rich creative beats, a body like a parable of dawn that seemed a niche for veiled divinity, or golden temple door to things beyond. As might a soul fly like a hunted bird, escaping with tired wings from a world of storms, and quiet reach like a remembered breast in a haven of safety and splendid soft repose, one could drink life back in streams of honey fire, recover the lost habit of happiness, feel our bright nature's glorious ambience, and preen joy in her warmth and colors rule. A deep of compassion, a hushed sanctuary, her inward help unbarred a gate in heaven. Love in her was wider than the universe. The whole world could take refuge in her single heart. The great unsatisfied Godhead here could dwell, vacant of the dwarf self's imprisoned air, her mood could harbor his sublimer breath, spiritual, that can make all things divine. For even her gulfs were secrecies of light. At once she was the stillness and the word, a continent of self-diffusing peace, an ocean of untrembling virgin fire. The strength, the silence of the gods were hers. In her he found a vastness like his own. His high, warm, subtle ether he refound and moved in her as in his natural home. In her he met his own eternity. Almost they saw who lived within her light, her playmate in the sempiternal spheres, descended from its unattainable realms in her attracting advent's luminous wake, the white fire dragon bird of endless bliss, drifting with burning wings above her days. Heaven's tranquil shield guarded the missioned child. For this she had accepted mortal breath, to wrestle with the shadow she had come, and must confront the riddle of man's birth, and life's brief struggle in dumb matter's night, whether to bear with ignorance and death, or hew the ways of immortality, to win or lose the godlike game for man, was her soul's issue thrown with destiny's dice. But not to submit and suffer was she born, to lead, to deliver, was her glorious part. Here was no fabric of terrestrial make, fit for a day's use by busy, careless powers, an image fluttering on the screen of fate, half animated for a passing show, or a castaway on the ocean of desire, flung to the eddies in a ruthless sport, and tossed along the gulfs of circumstance. A creature born to bend beneath the yoke, a chattel and a plaything of time's lords, or one more pawn who comes destined to be pushed, one slow move forward on a measureless board, in the chess play of the earth's soul with doom. Such is the human figure drawn by time. A conscious brain was here, a self-born force. Across each road stands armed a stone-eyed law. At every gate, the huge dim sentinel's pace. A gray tribunal of the ignorance, an inquisition of the priests of night, in judgment sit on the adventurer soul, and the dual tables and the karmic norm restrain the titan in us and the god. Pain with its lash, joy with its silver bribe, guard the wheel circling immobility. A bond is put on the high climbing mind, a seal on the too large, wide open heart. Death stays the journeying discoverer, life. Across the awful march, no eye can see. Barring its dreadful route, no will can change. She faced the engines of the universe. A heart stood in the way of the driving wheels. Its giant workings paused in front of a mind. Its stark conventions met the flame of a soul. A magic leverage suddenly is caught that moves the veil. Ineffable, timeless will. A prayer, a master act, a king idea can link man's strength to a transcendent force. The great world mother, now in her arose, a living choice reversed fate's cold dead term, affirmed the spirit's tread on circumstance, pressed back the senseless, dire, revolving wheel, and stopped the mute march of necessity. A flaming warrior from the eternal peaks, empowered to force the door denied and close, smote from death's visage its dumb absolute, and burst the bounds of consciousness and time. The end of Canto 2, Book 1. Canto 3, Book 1. A world's desire compelled her mortal birth. One in the front of the immortal quest, protagonist of the mysterious play, in which the unknown pursues himself through forms, and limits his eternity by the hours. and the blind void struggles to live and see, a thinker and toiler in the ideal there, brought down to earth's dumb need for her radiant power. His was a spirit that stooped from larger spheres into our province of ephemeral sight, a columnist from immortality, a pointing beam on earth's uncertain roads. His birth held up a symbol and a sign, his human self, like a translucent cloak, covered the all-wise who leads the unseen world. Affiliated to cosmic space and time, and paying here God's debt to earth and man, a greater sonship was his divine right. Although consenting to mortal ignorance, his knowledge shared the light ineffable, a strength of the original permanence, entangled in the moment and its flow. He kept the vision of the vast behind. A power was in him from the unknowable. A seer was born, a shining guest of time. For him, mind's limiting firmament ceased above. In the griffin forefront of the night and day, a gap was rent in the all-concealing vault. The conscious ends of being went rolling back. The landmarks of the little person fell. The island ego joined its continent. Overpassed was this world of rigid, limiting forms. Life's barriers opened into the unknown. Original and supernal immanence, of which all nature's process is the art, the cosmic worker set his secret hand to turn this frail mud engine to heaven use. A presence wrought behind the ambiguous screen, it beat his soil to bear a titan's weight, refining half-hewn blocks of natural strength. It built his soul into a statued god. The craftsman of the magic stuff of self, who labors at his high and difficult plan, in the wide workshop of the wonderful world, modeled in inward time his rhythmic parts. Then came the abrupt transcendent miracle the mask immaculate grandeur could outline, a travail in the occult womb of life, his dreamed magnificence of things to be, a crown of the architecture of the world, a mystery of married earth and heaven, and next divinity to the mortal scheme. He sat in secret chambers looking out into the luminous countries of the unborn, where all things dreamed by the mind are seen and true, and all that the life longs for is drawn close. He saw the perfect in their starry home, wearing the glory of a deathless form, lain in the arms of the eternal's peace, wrapped in the heartbeats of God ecstasy. He lived in the mystic space where thought is born and will is nursed by an ethereal power. and fed on the white milk of the eternal strength, till it grows into the likeness of a god. Lifting the heavy curtain of the flesh, he stood upon a threshold, serpent watched, and peered into the gleaming endless corridors. Silent and listening in the silent heart for the coming of the new and the unknown, he gazed across the empty stillnesses and heard the footsteps of the undreamed idea in the far avenues of the beyond. The kings of evil and the kings of good, appellants at the reason's judgment seat, proclaimed the gospel of their opposites, and all believed themselves spokesmen of God. The gods of light and titans of the dark battled for his soul as for a costly prize. There, knowing herself by her own termless self, wisdom supernal, word absolute, that uncompanioned in the eternal calm, all-seeing, motionless, sovereign, alone. The restless nether members tire of peace, a nostalgia of old little works and joys, a need to call back small familiar selves, to tread the accustomed and inferior way, the need to rest in a natural poise of fall, as a child who learns to walk can walk not long, replace the titan will forever to climb on the heart's altar dim the sacred fire. An old pull of subconscious chords renews. It draws the unwilling spirit from the heights, or a dull gravitation drags us down to the blind-driven inertia of our base. This, too, the supreme diplomat can use. He makes our fall a means for greater rise. Or into the ignorant nature's gusty field, into the half-ordered chaos of mortal life, the formless power, the self of eternal light, follow in the shadow of the spirit's descent. The twin duality, forever one, chooses its home mid the tumults of the sense. He comes unseen into our darker parts, and, curtained by the darkness, does his work, a subtle and all-knowing guest and guide, till they too feel the need and will to change. All here must learn to obey a higher law. Our body cells must hold the immortal's flame. Always the power poured back like sudden rain, or slowly in his breast a presence grew. It clambered back to some remembered height, or soared above the peak from which it fell. Each time he rose, there was a larger poise, a dwelling on a higher spirit plane. The light remained in him a longer space. Already in him was seen that task of power. Life made its home on the high tops of self. His soul, mind, heart became a single sun. Only life's lower reaches remained dim. But there too, in the uncertain shadow of life, there was a labor and a fiery breath. The ambiguous, cowled celestial puissance worked, watched by the inner witnesses, moveless peace. Even on the struggling nature left below, strong periods of illumination came. Lightnings of glory after glory burned. Experience was a tale of blaze and fire. Air rippled round the argosies of the gods. Strange riches sailed to him from the unseen. Splendors of insight filled the blank of thought. Knowledge spoke to the inconscient stillnesses. Rivers poured down of bliss and luminous forest. Visits of beauty, storm sweeps of delight, rain from the all-powerful mystery above. Thence stooped the eagles of omniscience. A dense veil was rent, a mighty whisper heard, repeated in the privacy of his soul, a wisdom cry from rapt transcendences, sang on the mountains of an unseen world. The voices that an inner listening hears conveyed to him their prophet utterances and flame-wrapped outbursts of the immortal word, and flashes of an occult revealing light approached him from the unreachable secrecy. An inspired knowledge sat enthroned within, whose seconds illumined more than reason's years. An ictus of revealing luster fell, as if a pointing accent upon truth. And like a sky flare showing all the ground, a swift intuitive discernment shone. One glance could separate the true and false, or raise its rapid torch fire in the dark to check the claimants crowding through mind's gates, covered by the forged signatures of the gods. Detect the magic bride in her disguise, or scan the apparent face of thought and life. Oft inspiration with her lightning feet, a sudden messenger from the all-seeing tops, traversed the soundless corridors of his mind, bringing her rhythmic sense of hidden things. A music spoke, transcending mortal speech, as if from a golden file of the all bliss, a joy of light, a joy of sudden sight, a rapture of the thrilled, undying word, poured into his heart as into an empty cup. A repetition of God's first delight, creating in a young and virgin time. In a brief moment caught, a little space, all knowledge packed into great wordless thoughts lodged in the expectant stillness of his depths, a crystal of the ultimate absolute. A portion of the inexpressible truth revealed by silence to the silent soul. The intense creatrix in his stillness wrought, her power fallen speechless, grew more intimate. She looked upon the scene and the unforeseen. On guest domain she made her native field. All vision gathered into a single ray, as when the eyes stare at an invisible point, till through the intensity of one luminous spot, an apocalypse of a world of images enters into the kingdom of the seer. A great nude arm of splendor suddenly rose. It rent the gauze opaque of nescience. Her lifted fingers, keen, unthinkable tipped, bared with a stab of flame the close beyond. She broke in with inspired speech for sight, and plundered the unknowable's vast estate, a gleaner of infinitesimal grains of truth, a sheaf binder of infinite experience. She pierced the guarded mysteries of world force, and her magic methods wrapped in a thousand veils, or she gathered the lost secrets dropped by time in the dust and crannies of his mounting route, mid old forsaken dreams of hastening mind and buried remnants of forgotten space. A traveler between summit and abyss, she joined the distant ends, the viewless deep, or streaked along the roads of heaven and hell, pursuing all knowledge like a questing hound. A reporter and scribe of hidden wisdom talk, her shining minutes of celestial speech passed through the masked office of the occult mind, transmitting gave to prophet and to seer the inspired body of the mystic truth. A recorder of the inquiry of the gods, spokesman of the silent seeings of the supreme, she brought immortal words to mortal man. Even were caught as through a cunning veil, the smile of love that sanctioned the long game, the calm indulgence and maternal breasts of wisdom suckling the child laughter of chance, silence the nurse of the Almighty's power, the omniscient hush, womb of the immortal word and of the timeless, the still brooding face, and the creative eye of eternity. The inspiring goddess entered a mortal's breast, made there her study of divining thought and sanctuary of prophetic speech, and sat upon the tripod seat of mind. All was made wide above, all lit below. In darkness core she dug out wells of light, on the undiscovered depths imposed a form, lent a vibrant cry to the unuttered vasts, and through great shoreless, voiceless, starless breadth, bore earthward fragments of revealing thought, hewn from the silence of the ineffable. Thus came his soul's release from ignorance, his mind and body's first spiritual change. A genius heightened in his body's self that knew the meaning of his fate-edged work, akin to the march of the unaccomplished powers beyond life's arc in spirit's immensities. Apart he lived in his mind's solitude, a demigod shaping the lives of men. One soul's ambition lifted up the race, a power work, but none knew whence it came. The universal strengths were linked with his, feeling earth's smallness with their boundless breadths. He drew the energies that transmute an age. End of Canto 3, Book 1 of Savitri.